So we're continuing this morning in our series called The Advent of Love. Remember, Advent means to arrive, and today's message is titled The Advent of Light. So we're going to talk about the arrival of a very bright light into our very dark world. And the passage we're using today is Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2, and then verse 6 and 7. So first, I'm going to read verse 2, and we're going to spend a little bit of time looking at this. It says, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned." So let's just first say, who are the people walking in darkness? It's talking here about all of humanity, all the inhabitants of the world. And this isn't just any kind of darkness. We're talking about a deep-seated darkness, meaning a very persistent stronghold of darkness. So I got to tell you three stories. One is, like, many years ago, I was shopping at a big box store at the mall. Somehow, I laid down on one of their bed displays, and I fell asleep. And when I woke up, the store's closed, and it's pitch black. I mean, you can't see a thing. Completely dark. So in a panic, I start groping my way, trying to find a wall or something, and something crashes to the ground immediately. And then I hear this voice that sounds a lot like my wife, Andrea, saying, "Gene, come back to bed. You're having one of those night terrors." So I used to have those when I was younger. A few years ago, Andrea and my mom and I were driving. We were staying at a beach house in Carlsbad, California, and we're driving on the 5 freeway. Anyone has driven on the 5 freeway before? No, you haven't. You crawl on the 5 freeway. Nobody drives on the 5 freeway. It's a parking lot. So it's nighttime. We're just north of San Diego. All of a sudden, the headlights on my mom's car goes out. I'm driving it. And being in my 60s, I can't see that good at night anymore. And that's a big problem, right? Like, how are we going to make it home? We have no lights. So I begin fidgeting around with the controls, and I figure out right away that the brights still work. So even though I know it's going to bug the driver in front of me, we had no choice because we really couldn't see very well. I wanted to get back home. And because the 5 freeway is almost always a parking lot, and it was this night, it was bumper to bumper, I could see that the guy in front of me is getting really bugged that I have my brights on. And the reason I know is because he's pushing his brake lights on and off pretty rapidly. And then he sticks his hand out, and he's driving this big Ford F-150 truck, and he sticks his hand out, and he does something with one of his fingers. So I'm thinking, this isn't going to go well. And sure enough, though, a few minutes later, he kind of changes lanes and I don't see him. But then all of a sudden, he's right behind me. And he's right on my bumper. And you guessed it, his big bright lights from his big truck are on. And I'm thinking, okay, this really isn't going to go well now. But after a mile or so, and it was very, very scary, kind of erratic behavior. After a mile or so, he changes lane. And fortunately, I never see him again. I thought for sure we'd end up on 7 News with the chopper. You know, in L.A., that's always the lead story. What chopper is chasing some car type of thing. So maybe you've also heard one more story, how Gil Dickinson and I, Gil often plays keyboard up here, same age. We got we ran up one summer evening up Green Mountain. Yeah, we ran up Green Mountain. It's an 8,200 peak. It's the second highest peak on the Front Range. And we didn't calculate the timing right, and we got caught with the sun going down, and it's pitch black. I mean, it's really, you know, with eyes, with our age, it's really hard to see even what's in front of us. So we made a pact that we would stick together, that we would go down this mountain together. And there were some times where we actually had to get on our knees just to make sure we were on the trail. But a few minutes into our little descent, I hear this faint voice, like I could barely hear it. "Hey, I thought we were going to stick together." And survival of the fittest, baby. I mean, I'm here. Where's Gil? All right. So I tell you these stories because in the physical sense, darkness is a real problem for us. We need a certain amount of light in order to function well in this world. But in our passage this morning, in Isaiah 9, and particularly verse 2, it's not talking about physical darkness, it's talking about spiritual darkness. And so it's addressing a persistent, deep-seated, destructive, and often debilitating darkness that keeps humanity continually struggling to flourish. Life is a struggle for so many people and so many people groups in the world, and no matter how enlightened or how educated or even spiritual we become as a collective humanity, we might be able to lessen the darkness a bit, but it never really disappears or relents from its destructive pursuit. Just read the headlines, and you can see this dark reality in action. There's anti-Semitism, there's racism, there's been ethnic cleansings, mass shootings, addictions, abuse, disease. I could go on. And many of us, many of you, could personally testify about how this kind of persistent, destructive darkness affects your life. But this passage is also addressing a light that will one day enter into our dark world. It will penetrate, it will conquer, and it will dispel this spiritual darkness for good. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. Now notice the imagery here. They're living in the darkness of light, but a light is dawned, has dawned. It's nighttime, but the sun is beginning to rise slowly above the horizon. Now, I don't know if you're aware of it or not. You probably are, but the majority of the great stories ever written are about a showdown between light versus darkness, or good versus evil. In storytelling, it's called a hero's journey, where the hero of the story ends up defeating the evil villain of the story. And whether that story is The Matrix or Batman or Braveheart or Star Wars or even The Lion King or Frozen, right? The hero's journey is by far the most predominant storytelling theme. And so not surprisingly, we also find the hero's journey theme the main storytelling theme in God's story, in this epic tale that God wrote. In fact, in God's grand story, it's the catalyst and it's the inspiration for all of those other storytellers, because all of those other storytellers are made in God's image, just like we're made in God's image. And this light versus darkness, this good versus evil theme, is embedded into their DNA, and it just oozes out of them into the thousands of smaller versions of God's grand story that have been written since the beginning of time. You and I and everyone else that's ever lived and everyone who is going to live in the future, we're all part of this story. Even though we never auditioned to play a role in it, we're part of it. Psalm 139 verse 16 says, "All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." What book is the psalmist talking about? He's talking about a book that God wrote here. It's his story, right? It's history, his story. It's God's grand story. It's all of the Bible and all of history. And like it or not, we're all stuck in a very, very long hero's journey that started a very, very long time ago. In fact, it's a tale as old as time, song as old as rhyme, Beauty and the Beast, another hero's journey theme, I might add. So what are the first three words of the Bible? What are they? In the beginning. In the beginning of what? In the beginning of his story, right? Genesis 1:1 is where God presses the play button. The story begins. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In other words, the first thing God did in his story was to build a stage upon which all of the other scenes of his story would be acted out. It's called planet Earth. And what an incredible stage it is. And in the next verse, in verse 2, Genesis 1:2, moments before God begins to create, we're told that the earth was formless and empty, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the water. I mean, just can you imagine that scene in your mind? There's only this deep abyss of darkness. And the Spirit is hovering over this abysmal scene, an ominous, somewhat disordered scene reminiscent of that time in all movies where the music score in the background becomes dark and dreary and you start biting your nails. And maybe it looked just like this. Scared? You're waiting for something to happen, huh? That's all there is. I mean, that's what the text says. We're not told how long this dark scene lasts, so I don't know how long these lights will stay down, but they're going to stay down. At some point in the next verse, it says, God says, let there be light, and there was light, and God saw that the light was good. Notice he doesn't say that the darkness is good, and he separated the light from the darkness, and he called the light day, and he called the darkness night, and there was evening, and there was morning the first day. And for the next 6 days, God creates everything in the universe, and maybe it looked a little bit like this. Feel the resolution from darkness to light? You're supposed to. Do you notice this creation pattern? First, darkness called night, then light called day. And did you notice how God embeds this darkness of night and the resolving of the light of day pattern into each and every day of our week? Let me read it to you again so that you can see this transition, this resolution from dark to light. God said, remember, it's all dark, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and he separates now the light from the darkness, and he calls the light day, and he calls the darkness night. And then it ends by saying, and there was evening first, and there was morning on that first day. First, the darkness of night, eventually resolving into the light of day. And you know, we're not so tuned into this kind of dark to light resolution because we start out our day in the morning. But in Israel, they still follow this darkness to light resolution. Their day still begins and ends when the sun sets. So they live each and every day experiencing the dread of darkness, but then turning into the resolution of light. It's dark, but hang on because daylight is coming. You're struggling now in the darkness, but the dawn will soon begin to show up above the horizon. This is why we read in Romans 13:12, this is not talking about a literal day. This is a metaphor. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. And so several thousand years ago, God said through the prophet Isaiah, he said, the people walking in darkness, a light has dawned. And a few verses later, he says through Isaiah again, for unto us a child is born, a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. This, of course, is a continuation from the verse that I spoke about last week, Isaiah 7:14, where a young virgin will supernaturally conceive and give birth to a child whose title will be Emmanuel, Emmanuel, God with us. And so two chapters later, here in Isaiah 9, we're given more information about this special child whose title in this section, chapter 7, verse 14, are reserved for names of God. And of course, this reinforces that this is not going to be any ordinary child. It's a very special child. This is going to be God incarnate, God in the human flesh, a special incarnate light, so to speak, that will penetrate the darkness of our world. The hero of the story, who will eventually defeat the evil villain, dispel all the darkness of this world once and for all. But remember that this light arrives like the dawn, which doesn't dispel the darkness all at once, but over a period of time as the sun begins to slowly rise above the horizon. In other words, over time, this light will increase and increase until there is no more darkness at all. That's exactly what this verse continues to say in Isaiah 9. Listen to what the next verse says. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. And he will reign on David's throne. Now we're talking about the end of the story. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And the zeal of the Lord will accomplish this. And so notice how this new heavenly government, which is the kingdom of God, right? The kingdom of God finally merges with us. Now this heavenly government, this kingdom of light, will defeat the kingdom of darkness by dispelling the darkness through the increasing ministry of justice and righteousness in the world. This light is going to set things right. Things that are broken, things that are lost, is going to be redeemed. In the New Testament, read in John chapter 1, verse 1 through 6, it tells us about this light that will enter into the world. This is John's Christmas story. Here's what it says. In the beginning, does that sound familiar? In the beginning, so we're going all the way back to the beginning of the story, was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We're talking about Jesus here. That's what John is declaring. And he says, he was with God in the beginning. In him, in Jesus, was life. And that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And so just like the passage in Isaiah 9, this is John's version of the Christmas story. Jesus is the light. And of course, in John 8:12, he declares, I am the light of the world. And whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And while Jesus walked this earth, he spent all of his time bringing that light into this dark world through his ministry of justice and righteousness. This is called tikkun olam in the Jewish world. It's also a phrase that we embrace here at Cornerstone Boulder. Tikkun olam is about working to heal a broken and fractured world. It's the ministry of redeeming things that are lost, lives that are shattered. And when Jesus began his ministry at the age of 30, he enters into a synagogue and he reads from the Torah. They hand him the Torah. The passage happens to be Isaiah 61, 1 through 2. And he declares, this is what I'm here for. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And then he said, today the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Wow, what a bunch of chutzpah this guy had. This is the light of justice and righteousness that Jesus brought into our dark world. But he would only be with us for 3 more years. And so knowing that his time is short, he tells us in Matthew 5:14, I'm leaving, but you're the light of the world. You're my light now. I'm handing you this ministry. He didn't hand it to just pastors. He didn't just hand it to just men. He handed it to everyone who's going to follow this rabbi. And you know, as characters in God's grand story, and you are one, even though you didn't sign up for it, we all have a special role in ushering in the light of dawn into this darkness, into the darkness of this world. That's what we're all supposed to do. I'm so proud that here at Cornerstone, our justice and mercy ministry is one way that we bring tikkun olam, healing, into this broken world. If you're not aware of it, let me tell you, every dollar that you get, we take 10% of every dollar that you give to Cornerstone, and it goes into the justice and mercy ministry to support our tikkun olam efforts locally and around the world. This year, our budget, the justice and mercy budget, it was $126,000. I love giving away money. You know, when I was a lead pastor, a lot of times you become like a bullseye for people that aren't very good at expressing their concerns, you know? Nobody targets you when you give away money. They just hug you. That's all you do. Okay, so I love it. It's a good kind of, you know, way to heal from 25 years or more than that. So roughly 60,000 of that budget goes to support the men and women here at Cornerstone who are in ministry, and also those who have gone abroad from Cornerstone that are in ministry, and also to support various organizations. So that's 60,000 goes there. In just a few minutes, we're going to give $10,000 to four of our Advent grant recipients. And so that's $100,000. The other $26,000 is discretionary giving throughout the year. At the beginning of our fiscal year last September, we started a new year-long initiative called Engage, connecting the love of Jesus to a broken world. And all of the projects we engage in this year are focused on issues that we can actually resolve in a year's time. And many of you have joined in some of those efforts and some of those projects. One of the projects that we're really excited to be involved in is those who are escaping life-threatening situations in their countries of origin, typically in the form of ethnic or religious persecution, and they're seeking asylum here in the United States. One of the organizations we work with is called Casa de Paz, and Casa de Paz means House of Peace, and they actually help when these asylum seekers, they're usually put into a detention center. There's one in Aurora, believe it or not, just about 45 minutes from here. They can stay there for months, and they can't leave. They're not allowed to leave. And so Casa de Paz, when they finally are released for processing, the decision won't be made maybe for a long time after that. Casa de Paz helps them, gives them a place to stay, and has a home that can house up to, like, I think 18 people now. And they also help with, you can actually be trained by Casa de Paz, and some of our people have here. You can actually go into the detention center and meet some of these asylum seekers. We've been helping them with some of their legal defense. Christy Gilbert, come on up, Christy, has been kind of leading that effort. She has been raising money on her own. This is so much fun. And by the way, if you're an attorney and you want to do some pro bono work around immigration, we'd love to talk to you about that. But I wanted to share a little bit. We're going to share one story about someone that Christy recently helped. Christy and her husband, Marty. Let's get some picture. This is, there's Christine. That's her husband, Marty. And then if you back up, this is Celestin. Oh, that's not his real name, right? I mean.
That is his name. That is his name, Celestin. It comes later as he'll introduce himself. And the first name comes later when they introduce themselves.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. All right. I heard something different on this. We're going to show you a little video clip of Celestin here. And he's an asylum seeker from Cameroon. If he was sent back, he would most likely be executed. He was held in this Aurora Detention Center for over 8 months. And like I said, Christy and her husband, Marty, have kind of personally took him on and befriended him and actually went to his hearings. And he was actually gained asylum about a month and a half ago, maybe 2 months ago.
Yes.
And he has a message for all of you. Christy took him. He had a brother living in Texas. And Christy took him to the airport. And on the way to the airport, she videoed him because he wanted to say something to you guys. So here it is.
Okay. I'm so happy you're free. Tell us what you'd like to tell us.
Yeah, I'm called Neba Celestine Gua from Cameroon. I left my country due to political instability, and leaving the country, it was not easy. But due to the special grace of God, I had to flee to the United States of America. When I arrived in the United States of America, I was being detained and under detention for over 8 months, of which it hasn't been easy. When I came, I knew I had no person who can help me here, but I've seen that there are a lot of people who have been helping. I want to really thank especially Pastor Gene, Mom.
That's Mom right there.
I want to thank Pastor Gene, and I also want to thank my mother, who has been helping me, Mark, Christy, and also the husband, who has really helped me a lot in detention, Matty, and everybody in the congregation that have done their effort to assist them to be with me throughout this period of trial. I say period of trial because it was really a period of temptation, especially in detention. But God has been with me throughout this period because in detention, I never relent my effort by praying all days and night, calling on to the Lord, because in Jeremiah 33, verse 3, God says that when you call him, he's going to answer you. I've been there waiting all the time, calling his name, and he did his miracle as he does in Isaiah 35, verse 3-6, because he had to heal the blind to see, he had to make the lame to walk, he had to make the dumb to speak, and the deaf to hear. So that is the power of miracle. When you believe and trust in the Lord, nothing is impossible for him to do to you. So I'm really happy because at the end of the day, when I got up the last day, I said, God, you asked me, you said I should be patient, as you said in Exodus 14:14, that I should be patient.
He's quite
because when the time comes, when the moment comes, when the hour comes, when the minute comes, he's going to give what I want. I asked him, I went down on my knee, I cried. I said, God, today is my day. I've been waiting for this day. You should give my asylum, you should grant it to me. Whoever immigration judge that is there, whoever government attorney, they should find favor in me. And it happens because I went in with that spirit of faith. I know something was done in my life. And I came out victoriously with my documents, which were granted to me. So I really want to thank God. I really want to appreciate God for everything he has done in my life, and also protecting my wife and children who are back home. I know you people will continue praying for me as I'm leaving Colorado, moving to Texas. We will be in spirit and we are going to continue praying. I believe one day I will be in the ministry to stand and testify as I'm saying like this, so that all of you people will see me physically and know that we serve a living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So I want to thank you all for everything, especially Mom, Christy, and the husband, and the pastor. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
So how can people get involved if they want to be part of this?
So you can see me out here later. And also, we're going to be launching or starting a host family group support system in order to help these guys when they get out. So we'll be talking more about that another time.
And we talked just on Friday that they have just opened a new detention center for children in Westminster. So it's a lot closer, and there's right now there's two teenagers there.
Right.
And there's opportunities for families to kind of maybe take them on.
Yeah, and we're not there yet, but we'll be talking more about that. We also have a legal fund that we've started, so that's another one.
Lots of good stuff. Yeah. All right, thanks. Stay here. And I'm going to invite the rest of the Justice and Mercy executive team to come on up here, and all the recipients who are getting the Advent grants today, come on up. Make your way up here. I have a power team that helps me, with the exception of Amy Cologne, which I'll introduce in a second. Everybody is a volunteer. They just do this out of their own schedules and time and resources. So first, the team, Christy Gilbert, I introduced, and Jess Mulvaney is part of the team, and Catherine Chavanis is part of the team. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have trouble with the word.
I saw
trouble with the word Catherine. No. And then Amy Cologne on staff with me, and Anka Corbin, also a volunteer. And then Scott Rushek at the end, and who's missing here is Chuck Vaughn, who was here this first service but had to be somewhere. So thank you all for being part of this. We have really created a lot of opportunities, and we're just getting started. And now I want to introduce you to the four recipients. First, two that are outside of Cornerstone. Teresa, come on up here. Teresa, and tell everybody who you are and what organization you're with and what you do.
Well, good morning or afternoon. Thank you very much. My name is Tere Garcia, and I'm the Executive Director of Engaged Latino Parents Advancing Students' Outcomes, for short, El Paso. And I want to thank you because the efforts that we're doing, the coordinators, the organizers, all of us are Latinas, all of us are women, all of us come from another country, logically. And we see the need for our own people to understand the educational system, understand the way things are in the United States, understand the way things work in the United States. They are not just different, they are opposite. And no one is bad or good. No, not just, they are just opposite. So the only thing we need, besides everything else, is information. So this money allows us to continue giving information to our parents, our moms who have little Kirolinos from 0 to 5 that need to be ready to go into kindergarten. Because as you know, and you remember when you were a little kid, if you got to kindergarten and you know how to sit down, you know how to pay attention, you know how to listen, you know how to go with the flow, you did very well. And that's what we need to teach our little kiddos, certain rules, certain strategies, and they will be great. The parents learn these ideas, these new techniques, strategies, and their children have a greater opportunity to succeed, because these kiddos are going to stay here. These kiddos are going to be the citizens in the future, and they are going to be partners and are going to be together with your own kids. So you are helping us to make sure that our society here in the United States, all of it is going to be prepared and ready to tackle whatever issues we need to in order to make this country better. So I appreciate and I thank you. We have two programs. One is Éxito, the success program, where the kiddos are going to enter kindergarten and they're going to be ready and they're going to succeed. And the other one is El Paso Voice is a program that helps parents to see outside their home, to see the community, what is there, and the barriers that are in the community, and they are learning how to deal with those issues, who to talk to, what institutions. In that way, parents are able to solve the problems like everybody else, like you all do. So I appreciate that you are helping us, and I don't know if you know, but what you are doing, it really, really means so much to every single one of our parents. If they were here, they will be thanking you for everything. So I'm the representative, and I, gracias, big gracias. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And one of the things we're doing to build community with the Latin population here in Boulder County is we're doing a mural project, and a Latin mural with a couple Latin artists and a couple gringo artists, and we're going to have a lot of fun doing it, and we're going to build relationships that way. Andy is with Reintegra.
So Reintegra, Spanish, Reintegra, Spanish for reintegrate. And the idea of reintegrate, of we help survivors of human trafficking reintegrate into society, but reintegrate also has another meaning of taking what's broken and making it whole again. And so we do that in an environment of creating wholeness and coaching and helping them grow. The interesting thing is, actually, 5 years ago, I was on staff with Cornerstone at the time, and actually, it's been 10 Advent gifts now. Brian Carlucci and I came up with the idea of Advent giving, and 5 years ago, Reintegra was the first time. It was a project we were supporting, and that fall, it was founded in Mexico. It was a Mexican organization at the time, and the founder had passed away that fall. And I remember Brian asking me, should we pull Reintegra out? And I felt very strongly about the work that was happening. Women were attending university at the time and the support that they needed. And it was still unclear if the organization would continue. And so we did the Advent gift. And almost at the exact same time, we found out that everything closed in Mexico. And so I'm in that role. I want to be a good steward of the resources that you had given and also the need. And so we actually launched, be 5 years next month, Reintegra as a nonprofit here in the U.S., based in Boulder. And the first start was the Advent gift that you gave. And so over those 5 years, we've been helping women and who have come out, aged out of a safe home, a shelter, much like this guy in the video of asylum seekers. But this is four women or minors who've been victims of human trafficking. And as these women want to pursue education and things like that, Reintegra comes along as a program for them. And so we've started to see women already. They're working at the Supreme Court of Mexico or the Court of Appeals. They're nurses. They've started businesses. Some of them are continuing to study. And it's really grown. And many of you, I look around the room, not only has Cornerstone come around, but you've ran 10Ks, you've climbed 14ers, you've given through your businesses or individually, and you've really invested in the work of Reintegra. This last year, three of the women that we've been helping move to independence, they no longer need financial support from us. And so we are starting a transitional program with some younger women who are coming out of the safe home. They'll live in an apartment together. Even though it's three women that we're no longer supporting, three new women that we are, the cost increased because we needed a tia or an aunt to live with them and more staff help. And so your gifts this season will really go toward us really initiating this program. Actually, I'm wiring money either tomorrow or the next day to help start this program. So thank you so much for what you do and invest. It's a real encouragement to me. Thank you.
Okay, the next two are actually ministries under Cornerstone umbrella, and Jess, come up and tell us about Families Infusion.
Okay, so Families Infusion is our foster and adoption care ministry here at Cornerstone, and we start from the core belief that every child deserves a safe and a loving family, and we desire to see the gospel really just lived out and to obey James 1:27 through adoption and foster care. And so our goal or our mission is to support and connect our adoptive and foster care families here in our Cornerstone community, as well as to raise awareness within the larger community as to how all of you can support these families. And so with this Advent gift, we are starting an adoption fund at Cornerstone. The cost of adoption is often prohibitive and stressful to families. And so I am so excited that we're going to be able to help our very own families with that. And I just want to not forget that just looking beyond just the dollar signs, that this money represents real live children that are somewhere in the world today desperately in need of a family. And so on behalf of them, I want to say thank you, because your gifts will just forever change the directory of their lives.
That's awesome. And Anka is part of the team for in Uganda. Tell them what you're doing.
Sure. Most of you are probably familiar that we've been working alongside Pastor David in Uganda with the schools and clean water and a number of things. But what you might not know is that one of Pastor David's dreams is to get his people out of poverty and to find sustainable ways that don't rely only on gifts from foreign churches and things like that, so that they can build businesses and sustainable income, if you will. So recently, there is a savings and loan program that was initiated. So Cornerstone, with this initiative, is coming alongside on the savings side to match and just teach how to save. And then also, we're building the loan program to look at, you know, microloans and kind of the parameters for loaning and what are the skills and the support that they're going to need so that these loans can also be paid back and that they don't become these big burdens that they could become. We recently had a team of Cornerstone folks, Chuck Vaughn and Kevin Cox, that went over a few months ago just to assess what the economic opportunities are and how do we help them to build sustainable businesses, and really what can we do to kind of come alongside them within that. So we're working on the next steps for that. If there are those of you maybe that either have experience or just have a heart to, you know, look at how do we do that, how do we build businesses, how do we kingdom build in Uganda, we would certainly love to have you come join us. But anyway, your money is going to go towards those things in Uganda, and we just are really grateful for all the generosity. I think there's so much that can be done here, and maybe we can even roll that out to other areas. So, thanks.
Awesome. So all these folks will be out in the foyer by the video wall after, if you want to know how to get connected to these projects and even more. But on behalf of Cornerstone, we'd like to present you all with a $10,000 check. And so Amy's got those for you. Yeah. And I need maybe a couple people that have a phone that could take a picture. We're going to take another photo up here, a little photo op. So all of you up here in the front, and we'll kind of go behind you a little bit. Anybody? Come on. Somebody with a phone. Anybody have a phone? Come on. Get up close. There you go. All right. Let's give him another hand. Is that awesome or not? And just one thing to wrap up with this message. In Revelation 22, in chapter 22, it talks about how there will no longer be any curse. You know, the fall in the garden is what got us off into this dark path to begin with. And eventually that's going to end at the end of the story, when the Messiah comes back and establishes the kingdom of heaven on earth permanently, all the darkness goes away. It says they will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign with him forever and ever. You know, it says just before this, it says that God is the light and Jesus is the lamp. You know what the word lamp is in Hebrew? It's menorah. And the reason why Hanukkah was such a big deal to get that lamp lit is because God commanded that lamp in the temple to stay lit all the time. It could never go out. It was a picture, a foreshadow of the light of the world who would come on Christmas, who will eventually come back. We won't even need the sun or the moon or any artificial light. Jesus and God is only the light we'll need. This is the Christmas message.